for his next class, The Enemy of the Jews.
Well, welcome back, everyone. We pick up the narrative then, having Esther just gone through a year of preparations, right? With 6 months, an oil of myrrh, and 6 months with sweet odors to come before the king. And we saw last class, these were symbols for dedication to God through his word and dedication to God through prayer. We looked at the key idea of obedience and its importance in our day and age as we prepare for Christ's return. This afternoon, we come to a time, that great time of anticipation, when for a whole year you have been waiting and preparing to go before the king of Persia, the king of the earth. As it says in verse 13, each maiden was allowed to take whatever she desired to have with her to go to the king's house. Did you note what Esther took? Verse 14, in the evening she went, and on the morrow she returned into the second house of the women to the custody of Sheashgaz, the king's chamberlain, which kept the concubines. She came in unto the king no more, except the king delighted in her, and that she was called by name. Now when the turn of Esther, the daughter of Abihail, the uncle of Mordecai, who had taken her for his daughter, was come to go in unto the king, she required nothing but what Haggai, the king's chamberlain, the keeper of the women, appointed. And Esther obtained favor in the sight of all them that looked upon her. Esther required nothing except with what she had prepared with, a mind engaged with what God was speaking to her, and a mind that communicates with her father, her true father, Yahweh, the true father of strength. You can only imagine what all the other ladies required to take from the house of the women, such as all the accessories one could have, but this maiden, this Hadassah, required none of it. This, young people, ought to be the way we are in our lives. We ought to focus and require only what God gives to us in his word, and communicate back to our Father in thankfulness without all the baggage or accessories that we could bring before God. You see, the problem with the first queen, as our brother Jamin a few years ago nicely put, said that there was an issue with this queen regarding her character, and it would only be a change in character that would result in a successful applicant to be queen of the world in a time of Persian domination. You might think, well, look at verse 15. It says, all that looked upon her. It was all about her beauty. But that's not so, young people. How is character discerned? By our sight. The way one carries themselves, the way they look at others, the way they smile, perhaps. You see, character is also discerned on what we see or hear. So keeping to the strict seeing of someone else and what they look like is only the story of what we see in someone physically. But we ought to look to what God can see in us by way of character. For nothing is hid from him. Potentially, this echoes to the time when we will be judged, when we will be divided. To the left or to the right? To the king's house or to the second house? As goats or sheep? What are we going to take with us, young people? I can assure you there is nothing you can wear or take with you that's going to help. It's the preparation right now. Day after day, in the reading, in the study of God's word, and in our communication back to God in prayer, that we may develop a strong relationship with him. So Esther goes in unto the king, verse 16. So Esther was taken unto King Ahasuerus into his house royal in the 10th month, which is the month Tebeth, in the 7th year of his reign. And the king loved Esther above all the women, and she obtained grace and favor in his sight more than all the virgins, so that he set the royal crown upon her head, and he made her queen instead of Vashti. Esther obtained grace and favor in the sight of the king more than all the other maidens. Was this because she was beautiful? No. Undoubtedly, she was beautiful, but so were the many women in the house of the women. This Esther was special, special because of her character, special because of who she had become. Special, but not because of her beauty. Clearly, there was a great contrast between Esther and Vashti. Both of them were physically beautiful, but only one had a beauty of heart and mind. Young people, who are we trying to be? Because we can really only have an effect on one of these. We can't control our genes, but we can control our minds. We can control what we do with our minds, what we choose to think about, what we do with our time. To make the contrast greater between Vashti and Esther, the very first thing the king does is fulfill that of Proverbs 12, verse 4, that we looked at. A virtuous woman is a crown to her husband, but she that maketh ashamed is as rottenness in his bones. Esther is crowned, young people, because she is a reflection and a crown to her husband. But the contrast doesn't end there. It then goes on to specifically mention that Esther is made queen instead of Vashti, which is like the rest of the verse in Proverbs, speaking potentially about Vashti. A great wedding feast was had, and what was told of the character of Esther, verse 20, that she obeyed Mordecai, even though she now had power over him. Now that tells us of the character of Esther, not one to act over others just because of the position she now had. She still showed great respect and sobriety to Mordecai, who had raised her. And then, young people, the narrative completely changes. Verse 21, in those days, while Mordecai sat in the king's gate, two of the king's chamberlains, Bigthan and Teresh, of those which kept the door, were wroth and sought to lay hand on the king Ahasuerus. And the thing was known to Mordecai, who told it unto Esther the queen. And Esther certified the king thereof in Mordecai's name. And when inquisition was made of the matter, it was found out. Therefore, they were both hanged on a tree, and it was written in the book of the Chronicles before the king. Bigthan, according to Jesenius, means gift of fortune, and Teresh means severe or austere. Google says fortune can mean chance or luck as an external, arbitrary force affecting human affairs. What might the gift be speaking about causing this force to act in human affairs against the severe or austere? Well, that is a discussion for another time. I would recommend examining this in your studies in the book of Esther. Well, we come to chapter 3 then, where the story of Esther really seems to begin. Verse 1, again, says, after these things, did King Ahasuerus promote Haman, the son of Hammedatha of the Agagite, and advanced him, and set his seat above all the princes that were with him. We are introduced to this Haman, the son of Hammedatha the Agagite. Jesenius says that Haman means magnificent or illustrious. Hammedatha literally means father of Haman. And the Agagites, according to Smith's Bible Dictionary, relates, of course, the king of the Amalekites called Agag with the Agagites as seen in 1 Samuel 15, when Saul spared King Agag of the Amalekites. What did Samuel think of this action of Saul? Well, in verse 33, it says that he hewed Agag in pieces before the Lord in Gilgal. A gory scene, but one in which reflects the kind of people that Israel was facing and what ought to be done to them. For the children of Israel had a long history with this nation located near their land. You see, this people, this man, Haman, represents in part the flesh in all its glory and wickedness. Sin, iniquity, transgression, and how it is manifested in our lives. And what ought to be done to Haman in each of our lives, young people? He must be hewed in pieces, completely destroyed, wiped off the face of the earth. Sin in our lives must not be given any chances, but smothered out, that it is given zero opportunity to raise its ugly head. As our brother H.B. Mansfield says about Haman, I quote, "He represented the seed of the serpent in its various manifestations. He was granted power for a time. He was known as the Jews' enemy. He sought to destroy Mordecai. He was forced to honor Mordecai. He was committed to attend the banquet of wine and was afterwards hung on his own gallows. His 10 sons were slain after him." Haman thus typifies the flesh in several manifestations. He represented the seed of the serpent, which sought to put Christ to death, but in so doing encompassed its own destruction. He also represented the flesh yet to be politically manifested in Gog, who will be destroyed after causing the time of Jacob's trouble. He also foreshadowed the flesh ecclesiastically, manifested in the man of sin, who is to be destroyed at Christ's coming together with his 10 sons. End quote. Hence, young people, a fascinating character to look at. Well, in verse 2, after Mordecai refused to bow, it set this man off in a frenzy of anger to attempt to kill an entire nation of people. In another word, genocide of Israel. This man's pride was like no other. When we quickly survey the Psalms and Proverbs, there are many helpful verses, of which we will quickly look at a few. I've got them up on the screen for you. Those who have pride are described as proud, and they will persecute the poor. They will not seek God. There will be sin, cursing, and lying from their lips. They stand out. It's evil. Shame follows. Contention is a result. They have a mouth of foolishness. Destruction follows. And they will be brought low. So what is the result of Haman's pride here in Esther? Verse 5, it says, "And when Haman saw that Mordecai bowed not, nor did him reverence, then was Haman full of wrath. And he thought scorn to lay hands on Mordecai alone, for they had showed him the people of Mordecai. Wherefore Haman sought to destroy all the Jews that were throughout the whole kingdom of Ahasuerus, even the people of Mordecai. In the first month, that is the month Nisan, in the 12th year of the king Ahasuerus, they cast pur, that is the lot, before Haman from day to day and from month to month, to the 12th month, that is the month Adar." So what does verse 7 mean? Does it mean he cast lots every day to determine a day to wipe out the people of Mordecai? Well, it means, young people, that he cast lots in order to choose the month and the day specifically in which to kill the children of Israel. So as an example, the casting of lots was put up to chance, just like these dice. You roll these dice, right? So Haman would have wanted to choose the month and the day. Okay? All right, the 12th month. Let's choose a day now. The 13th day, right? So that gives us an example of what the casting of lots would be like rolling the dice. And so Haman was willing to pay 10,000 talents of silver to the hands of those that have the charge of the business to bring into the king's treasuries. Come with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 4, please. This is where this number shows up again, giving us a clue as to what it might represent. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. We will start at verse 9. First Corinthians 4, verse 9. For I think that God hath set forth us, the apostles, last, as it were appointed to death. For we are made a spectacle unto the world, and to angels, and to men. We are fools for Christ's sake, but ye are wise in Christ. We are weak, but ye are strong. Ye are honorable, but we are despised. Even unto this present hour, we both hunger and thirst, and are naked, and are buffeted, and have no certain dwelling place. And labor, working with our own hands, being reviled, we bless. Being persecuted, we suffer it. Being defamed, we entreat. We are made as the filth of the world, and are the offscouring of all things unto this day. I write not these things to shame you, but as my beloved sons, I warn you. For though ye have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet have ye not many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel. Wherefore, I beseech you, be ye followers of me. 10,000 instructors in Christ. And so we have the symbol or representation of the saints here in Esther. And sadly, they were being sold for their very lives. Look at how Haman describes the Jews back in Esther. Verse 8, he calls them a certain people, scattered abroad and dispersed. Their laws are different, and they don't keep your laws, my king. And hence it's in your best interest to rid them of the land, in the land of these people. And so in verse 10, Haman is given the ring from the hand of the king in order to write this letter to all the kingdom and to sign it with the king's power and authority. Clearly, Haman was overcome with greed in his mind, and he was giving incentive for others to kill the Jews, as it says at the end of verse 13, that others were to take a spoil of them for a prey. Young people, when was the day the Jews were to be wiped off the face of the earth? Well, as we saw, Haman was to choose a month and a day, and he did this in the first month of Nisan. Well, it just so happens to be the month they were to face this great trial, was to be at the end of the year, the 12th month of Adar. You can just picture the angel of God causing the dice, as it were, or manner of casting lots to be put to luck or chance, Haman thought. But who created this law in our universe? God did. In the providence of God, we see how the Jews were given essentially the maximum amount of time to respond and prepare for this great trial they would all face. Clearly, it was all in the hands of God. And so it was specifically put at the end of the year when the children of Israel had the pulling of flax, had the citrus fruit harvest, and they had the latter rains. And this month is when Purim would be instituted. And what day? Why, of course, the day of rebellion in symbol, the day of the enemies of the Jews, when the enemy would seek to kill its prey the 13th day. Well, if Haman only knew what Scripture had to say with regard to cursing the Jews, please come with me back to Genesis chapter 12, where we have the blessings given to Abraham. Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 says, "Now the Lord had said unto Abram, Get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed." So Abram departed, as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. So those who bless Israel would be blessed, and those who curse Israel would be cursed. This outworks itself today and can be seen as a physical law of the earth. And we know there will be a time to come shortly in our lives where we will see a great cursing against Israel. But that will lead to the complete destruction of the enemy of the Jews, who was in old time, will be led by Agag, by Haman. But Haman had no idea who he was dealing with. But neither did most in Persia. And what was the result? Verse 15. At the end, the city of Shushan was perplexed. And what does Haman do? For the first time in verse 10 is described as the Jews' enemy. It says, "The post went out, being hastened by the king's commandment, and the decree was given in Shushan the palace, and the king and Haman sat down to drink. But the city, Shushan, was perplexed. He sat down to eat and drink, thinking that it was by the king he could trust and have power to do what he desired. But little did he know this was so far from the truth." It was quite the opposite, really. But to the Jews' young people, all seemed lost. All was determined to end. They had only 11 months left to live. What would you do if you only had 11 months left to live? Think of the disparity that they were feeling and were in, young people. This great trial they were in. This seemed like an impossible mountain to climb. It seemed as though God hid his face from them. It seemed that they were all doomed. All is lost. Goodbye. It appeared that this was the time to give up. It seemed as though this was the time when they had no more time. Young people, what do we do when we are under trial, great or small? Under trial that is intense, painful, hurtful physically, emotionally, spiritually. What is your attitude? What do you do? What do you think? What do you say? Who do you speak to? What happens next? Well, on your handout, which hopefully you all have, I printed 10 more copies at the back if you don't, we have a small section where we can do a mini workshop together. We have the questions, which are also up on the screen. What do we think, say, do in trial, and who do we put our trust in during trial? Well, we'll take the next 10 or so minutes to fill some of the verses and ideas we find on trial. But in order to make this simpler and to narrow our search, we are going to look at only the epistle when the Jews were undergoing trial, as they were scattered abroad among the nations before them, the epistle of James. So come to the book of James and write only verses found in the book of James that relate to each of the questions. Please turn there with me. Scan over the chapters and verses and try to come up with a verse or list of verses and the key idea of the verse beside each of the questions. These can also be related principles to the question, such as not only what we say, but how we say what we say. You can add to your list, and if I've missed something, come up to me after and share what you found, please, because I'd love to add to my list as well. So the first question is, what do we think in trial? And this one comes up nice and early in the book of James, chapter 1, verses 2 and 3, right? We count it all joy, having a positive mindset towards trial, knowing that despite the pain, despite what we are facing, it will produce fruit, and that glory will be brought to God in doing so. What do we say in trial? We must be slow to speak. We must not kindle fires. We must bridle our tongues. Blessing ought to be the only thing from our mouths. We need to ask for the right things. Well, how about what we do in trial? We must be dedicated to prayer. We have to have endurance. We must be swift to hear, be slow to wrath, be doers of the word, focusing on others, have an alive faith in God by doing. We must have works with meekness and wisdom. And finally, who do we put our trust in when in trial? Well, of course, God, and in that which is eternal. So there are all the questions, if you need to write any of them down, some of the verses. Well, what did we learn in the earlier sections of Esther about trial? We need to obey our Heavenly Father. We need to read His word every day. We need to pray to our God, our Father of strength, every day. We ought to take the example of the examples of Mordecai and Esther, who diligently prepared for her turn to come before the king. She had no idea what would happen next to her. She wasn't sure if it was meant to be. She wasn't sure that she was doing the right thing. She wasn't sure. But she followed after the example and commands of Mordecai and obeyed, that she might be counted faithful, that she might indeed prepare in the way she could to come before the king of all the earth. She took her trust in the ecclesia that she might be helped to that goal for the honor and glory of God. This, young people, is how we ought to move through trial, no matter the difficult circumstances that we face in our lives. Well, young people, all seemed lost. And in our next class, we will see the providence of God. We will see a miracle performed, but not in the days of Esther, in our day. So we can see how God's hand still works in this earth, despite how insignificant our lives may feel at times. We will see how God helped in trial. We will see death, but we will see life again. And who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this.